Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Purdy Insurance. Visit Purdy Insurance on Market Street in Sunbury or visit online at purdyinsurance.com.
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way. The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Take, for example, if you work with somebody that can be a little clumsy around you, for example. Suit. You may want more insurance. Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Tell me I'm wrong, Matt.
No, you are not wrong.
Oh, my goodness. Have you ever seen anybody brag more about what they do athletically, and then all of a sudden you're out there and you face them and realize it just doesn't happen?
I may or may not have been there.
What are you talking about? Oh, okay. We're going to have, a Bucknell-centric show today, right?
Yep, really, a couple times this week. We got Nate Davis today at 3:35 for the men as they get ready for the opening round game of the Patriot League Tournament tomorrow against Holy Cross. And then we have Trevor Woodruff, the Bucknell women's coach of the regular season champion Bison, on Thursday at 4:06.
Well, the bottom line is you are their guy.
I got some connections, yeah.
You're their guy. Now, you do the men's games as well as the women, right?
Correct.
Plus football.
Plus football.
You're the guy. You and Birdsong. Anybody else is kind of an add-on. Oh, I hate that guy. Yeah, it's like, man, alive. Yeah, the further they advance, the more we hear you in the background. Then there's Doug making his calls, like, whoa.
Of course.
Oh. Does that little John Sterling there. Yankees win. Yankees win. Oh, God. Remember when I did the pinstripe ball, they said, you have John Sterling's chair. I said, yes, but it's in the end zone. They're like, well, yeah, that's actually true. And factual. All right. Can we start with Tony Romo tonight? Let's start with Tony Romo. Actually, I would like to actually start. Actually, let me start with Penn State wrestling. Might as well get to the newsy part of the news. Then we'll get to Tony Romo. How about that? Okay? So we'll do it that way. And the reason I want to start with Penn State wrestling is they did announce the seedings today for the Big Ten Championships, which will take place at the Rutgers Athletic Center in beautiful downtown Piscataway, New Jersey. Okay, maybe they didn't come off the way I hoped it would.
Yeah, I can confirm that's a bit of a stretch, but I get where you're going.
I don't know. But they'll be at the rack, which for 2 years, by the way, was the home of the New Jersey Nets. You can use that piece of trivia with your friends and neighbors as you drive to the rack to watch the Big Ten Championships. Like, really? The Nets played here? That's when they were building the Meadowlands way back when. Of course, now they're in Brooklyn, so the Meadowlands didn't completely work out. Let's see. Big Ten Wrestling Preseeds. Here we go. Here are the preseeds. Penn State has three number one preseeds for the Big Ten Championships. Nick Lee, Brooks, and Vincenzo Joseph. So here are the seeds at 125. I'm not going to read them all. I'm going to tell you who the number one seed is, and I'm going to tell you where the Penn State wrestler is seeded. Spencer Lee of Iowa is the number one seed at 125, and Brandon Meredith of Penn State is 14. At 133, Seth Gross of Wisconsin is the number one seed. Roman Bravo Young of Penn State is the number two seed, and that is a very dangerous number two seed. 141, the number one seed is Nick Lee of Penn State, and as expected, Luke Pletcher of Ohio State's the number two seed. They had that great matchup in the Jordan Center. 149, Sammy Sasso from the eastern part of the state. He's from Ohio State, but he's from the eastern part of our state. He is the number one seed. And the number eight seed is Jared McLaren of Penn State. He's number eight. 157, Ryan Dakin of Northwestern is the number one seed. And the Bo Pfeiffer is the number 13 seed at 157. 165, Vincenzo Joseph, as expected, is the number one seed. By the way, Alex Marinelli of Iowa is number two. At 174, the number one seed, as expected, Michael Kemmer of Iowa. He beat Mark Hall. He deserves to be the number one seed. And Mark Hall is the number two seed. But Mark Hall is, I think, wrestling at his best heading into this. Really got rolling with that Ohio State pin. Hall's really wrestling well right now. Kemmer should beware. Number one seed at 184 is Aaron Brooks of Penn State. At 197, Colin Moore of Ohio State is the number one seed. Shakur Rashid is the number six seed at 197. And at 285 plus heavyweight, Mason Paris of Michigan is the number one seed. The number seven seed is Seth Nevels. Gabe Stevenson, by the way, is the number two seed from Minnesota at heavyweight. But Seth Nevels is number seven. So there you go. There are the seeds for the upcoming Big Ten championships taking place at the rack. I don't think there's anything there that was surprising. Those will be pretty close to these seeds for the Nationals as well. I mean, the Big Ten is the number one conference in wrestling by a wide margin nationally. So that's where the seeding happens to be. Rack this weekend. Be there. Aloha. And now let's get to Tony Romo. I'm not going to get into the Simple Simon deal, which is like the typical talk show thing. Let's just do it the simplest way. $17 million. Is anybody worth $17 million? Does anybody watch just because of who announces and blah, 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 blah? No. That's not how we're going to do this. Okay? The reason that we're not going to do this that way is because, to me, that's not what this means, okay? First of all, I'm happy for what anybody gets. Okay? I'm happy for what anybody gets. Pretty simple. He did not, I said this before, remember with Ryan Howard, I said this, oh, look at it, he makes too much money, blah, 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 blah. I said, excuse me, he did not hold people in a room and then release them one at a time until he got the money. The management said, oh, yeah, we're with you. This is what we think we'll give you. Okay. Well, CBS thinks he's worth $17 million to what they're doing. Okay. That's fine. He didn't hold the management in a room and release them one by one until he got 17. That aside, this is what it means. Matt, how much streaming do you do of shows right now?
Let's see. The only thing I've been streaming currently is the All or Nothing series for the Eagles on Amazon Prime.
The Eagles, All or Nothing. Okay. More and more young people are streaming. Or, look, and there's another part, too, that comes with this. And that is as follows. Right now, live sports, and live sports is part of what drives what we do, live sports is the only unpredictable television out there that you have to really watch live to appreciate. You can DVR any program. You can go to Netflix anytime you want, Amazon Prime anytime you want, or, hey, look, okay, you know, I wasn't home this week to see NCIS. I can watch that tomorrow night. Sports, you can't do that with. Because, let's face it, most people do not want to watch something where they already know the final score. Oh, I was going to watch that Providence-Villanova game. Oh, I don't want to watch. I see they lost by 4. I don't want to watch that. I'm a big Creighton fan. I can't wait to watch Creighton-St. John's. I DVR'd. They lost by 20? Well, I'm not going to watch that. Sports is something you have to see live. It's just the way it is. Remember, this is one of those arguments the suit and I had about, right? Oh, no. You can DVR. And I said, that's not how it works. So, I can't watch it if I know what the final score is. Or unless, for example, I mean, I'm doing it for work purposes. Then I got to say, okay, how'd they win? How'd they lose? You know, I'm trying to look at the personnel. I mean, I sat there and watched the Michigan State scout tape last night. Well, that's a little bit different. That's work. But that is, that's where it is now. Live sports. So to me, the significance of the Tony Romo $17 million a year deal is CBS really wants to desperately be the major player in the NFL moving forward. This is a sign that they want to be a major player. They know they need to be a major player because CBS has been out of the NFL business in the 90s when Fox got the NFC contract and NBC was with the AFC. Then CBS got back in it with the AFC package, and NBC then eventually, after being out of it, got Sunday Night Football. Dick Ebersol worked hard to get that. The Players Association and the new collective bargaining agreement, the NFL is desperate to have that done now. They're desperate to have it done now because they then want to sit down with the TV people and get the new TV deals worked out. And they feel that by going to the TV networks and saying, we have 10 years of labor peace, oh, and we have more inventory, a 17th game, and oh, we have more inventory, 2 more playoff games every year. The idea is to get more money. And the TV networks, CBS is certainly showing the willingness that, look, we're going to be a serious player in all of this. Look what we just did, quote, with Tony Romo. Because, again, live sports is a driver. After that, it'll be the Big Ten. Remember, the Big Ten was the last to negotiate in the most recent television deal. But it was a 6-year deal they put together with Fox, ESPN, CBS, and, of course, BTN. Which meant being the last in the most recent cycle at 6 years means they'll be first in the next cycle. And this will be the first major contract that Kevin Warren, the new Big Ten commissioner, will negotiate. The idea is to get more money. And the Big Ten chalked up big ratings this year. Penn State had highly rated games. Ohio State had highly rated games. And in basketball, the competition in basketball has been off the charts this year in the Big Ten. They have more inventory than ever. Remember, when the Big Ten negotiated this, they had 18 conference games in basketball. Now they have 20 where they control the inventory. I mean, why do you have 20 basketball games in the Big Ten, which is an incredible grind? I mean, Penn State's already played 18 Big Ten games. They still have two more to play plus the tournament. But why do you have that many? Inventory. Why does the Big Ten play nine Big Ten? Why does the Big Ten play nine conference games in football? Inventory. You control the inventory. And that's where it becomes important. The TV deals are critical moving forward, and right now the iron is hot for TV. The iron is hot. TV feels they need the live, exciting programming. You can sit there and you can stream and you can DVR programs. Live sports is something that's very hard to... Yeah, you can you DVR it? Sure. But is the desire to watch it lessened when you already know what the score is? And the TV people know that, and more importantly, the leagues and the conferences know that. Tony Romo's $17 million deal confirms to me the mindset of what the networks think when it comes to live sports. It's critical to them. That's what the Tony Romo deal means to me. Now, for Tony Romo, they'll ask him, what does the NFL mean to you? And he says, $17 million a year contractually.
For nearly 100 years, Purdy Insurance has been your locally owned, family-operated source for insurance products. With a staff of over 20 and partnerships with some of the industry's most trusted companies, Purdy has the experience and resources to get the job done. Whether you need personal, home, and auto, or complex business insurance solutions, Purdy will help you navigate through the process. Call today at 570-286-5855, or better yet, stop in their Sunbury office to see what Purdy Insurance can do for you.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Purdy's have served this valley for decades, finding their customers the right insurance, auto, home, life, business, bundles, whatever it may be. Purdy Insurance, best in the business. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. We're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Patriot League Tournament gets rolling tomorrow. Soika, it'll be Holy Cross and Bucknell. Joining us, the fine head basketball coach at Bucknell, Nathan Davis. Nate, welcome back. It's great to have you with us.
As always, it's my pleasure. Thanks for having me on.
Nathan, you won three of your last five games. So what has come together that's put you in a better spot?
Well, I think we've been a little more consistent as far as concentration on personnel and things defensively, and then playing together offensively. I think when we've done that, we've been pretty good. When we haven't, we've struggled.
Okay, so now when you look at your team, I'm talking about winning three of the last five. You've getting about, I think, about 38% of your production in conference play from the three-point line. Is that really, in the end, a barometer for you?
Well, I think it is, as long as we're getting good shots. I mean, at the end of the day, we played 31 games, and so the reality is we're really more of a jump-shooting team than anything else. But saying that, we've still got to get paint touches. We've got to finish a little bit better when we get to the rim and when we get in the paint, also we can draw some fouls. But we're at our best. We're playing inside out, driving and kicking and getting step-in rhythm jumpers.
All right, so now let's get to the inside part of it. It's late in the game. Maybe you need it too. Let's face it. There's certain coaches that can draw up something. Let's give Patrick Chambers the do. If he needs to go with something, go to Lamar Stevens. Okay. Some teams can do that. Obviously, I just watched McCaffrey. He can go to Luka if he wants. Mm-hmm. Can you draw up something like that with your inside post players, or does it really have to be an inside-out game for you?
It's got to be inside-out. For us, the big thing is, I don't know that, like you should say, we don't have the one guy that's going to break down a defense. Going to command a double team in the post, going to be the guy one-on-one. But what we do have is always our five guys on the floor that can make plays, whether it's drive a closeout, make an open shot, finish at the rim, pass it. So we've just got to make sure that we get in a position where we can force help and read the play and be ready to knock it down, whether it's at the rim for a layup. Sometimes it is throwing the post. The other day it would be Coley was on a ball screen roll. Our center got fouled. It's been times it's going to be a three. We just got to make sure we make the right play and play together.
The Colgate game was won dramatically. What did that do for that locker room?
Well, I think it was certainly a relief. Obviously, we'd come off a stretch. We lost five in a row, which is not what anyone wanted. But to play at home, play the team that had already won the league, that had actually beaten us now three times in a row, going back to last year, I think was a sign of what we're capable of, and hopefully we continue to grow from that.
Have you heard Doug's call of the last play?
I have not, no. I always, whenever I'm watching the film, I watch it with a sound on.
I understand. I got that part. No, I understand that. I just didn't know if maybe in your travels. Hey, Matt, do you have that for him?
I can. Let's play real quick.
You got to hear this, Nathan. You got to.
Here comes Colgate. Burns with it. 5 seconds left. Burns blows by Sotos. Steps back for a jumper up and no good! No good! No good! Senior night!
That's your guy.
He is certainly very enthusiastic. One of the all-time nice people you'll ever meet.
Isn't he? Yep, and as somebody who's in the profession, I can tell you that he's an awesome play-by-play guy. So he's Bucknell's lucky to have him.
Yes, we are.
When you have looked at Brett Nelson's team, I mean, obviously they've had their struggles, but that doesn't mean they don't have guys that can threaten you. What do you think of guys like Few and Pridgen and guys like that?
Well, Pridgen, obviously, the freshman's had a great year. We just named the Rookie of the Year this year.
Right. And
certainly should have been. I mean, average, I think, 18 points a game as a freshman, which is pretty good at any level. So he's got that going for him. And then I think the kind of dynamic they have is with their bigs, when you throw them in with them, their bigs are 6'8", 6'9", but really are better shooters playing away from the basket than they are playing with their backs to the basket in the post, which actually helps Pridgen out a lot, and that he's better around the basket. So it's a matter of how you're going to match up. They do put, like I said, they put guys on the floor around him. They can shoot, and he can play multiple positions up front. So they've got some versatility to him. The big thing, I think, is they're obviously really, really young.
Yeah, no, there's no question. They are a very young team. It shows. Now, conversely, I want to talk about your defense for a moment. You've gone through a series of games here where you've held the opponent to 71 or fewer, I think, in each of the last six games. What has been better defensively for you? Have you found a better rotation out there as to how you play it?
Well, I think there's a couple things, and I think you touched on the rotation there. I think one thing that we fought with all year, and not to make excuses, is we just haven't had our guys available all the time.
That's right.
We've now played, I think, just 7 of our 18 league games where everyone's available. That's not counting practice time. We may have had 20 days since January 1st where everyone's been able to practice. So trying to get some continuity there and being able to finally get something a little bit over the last couple of weeks has certainly helped. I think that our guys, and to their credit, I think people talk about playing hard. When I say playing hard, I'm talking about not just the physical effort. There's a mental effort to it. And certain focus you have to have all the time. You got to know who you're guarding. You got to know who the other guys are, where they're trying to do so that you can help properly, so that you can know how we want to play certain people properly. And we do a lot of switching, so there's even more of it our guys got to know. I think they've done a much better job here with the last 2 weeks of embracing that and taking on the challenge of knowing personnel and being able to concentrate and pay attention to those details.
How important at this time of the year are mental reps, film reps, as opposed to practice court reps?
Oh, they're huge. I think that, obviously, you're doing stuff in practice. Practice is not nearly as long, obviously. But if you haven't guarded it by now or gone over it or seen it, you've done something wrong. And so, really, it's about and now, obviously, you played everyone really now twice, so you should have a good feel for what they do. So it's about making sure everyone understands what you're trying to accomplish, how you want to attack things, what they're running. So you should know how you're going to guard it. And then being fresh, because it's a long, long season.
these are also the ultimate possession games. I mean, it's the one-and-done time. Is there a different mentality that has to come to the table because it is a one-and-done situation?
I don't know that I would say it's a different mentality. If you're trying to change your mentality at this point, you're probably not going to do it.
I understand.
That's got to be something you've been building on all year. And one thing we talk about all the time is you got to try to win every possession, and it's as simple as that. It's harder to say, harder to do than it is to say, but you got to go out there and just focus on the task at hand. You can't worry about what happened. You can't think about what's going to happen next. You got to play that possession like it's the one that's going to win you the game, and then go on and play the next one the same way.
Have you played, because of the injury situation, have you played some guys more minutes earlier than maybe you had thought about in the preseason? And if so, could there be actually some benefit down the road next year because they did get some force-fed experience?
I think it's certainly possible. I think that every year is a different thing, and guys across the board, obviously our record and where we are is not up to our standards, and we've all got to get better. I got to get better. Staff's got to do a better job. Our players got to get better, too, moving forward. And certainly having some extra experience will help. But at the end of the day, we've also all got to do a better job moving into next year.
What will be important tomorrow night when you face Holy Cross? What are some of the things you put up on that whiteboard for them to say, okay, remember this?
Well, the number one thing will be is just to win in advance. It's that time of year. Doesn't matter how you do it, get one more point and move on to the next one. It's the first thing. But to do that, we're going to have to, like I said earlier, I know it's kind of repetitive, but we have to do a great job understanding personnel and how we want to guard people. We got to understand how they're going to play, the certain things we're going to do so that we can get paint touches. And even though we're a jump shooting team, we want to play inside out because those shots are easier. And we got to play with pace. We got to make it a game that goes end to end and make them recover in transition and keep pressure on them.
Nathan, we're with you. Nothing but the best. You know, it's always a pleasure talking basketball with you, and good luck.
Thank you very much.
And you got to hear Doug's call. There you go.
I did. You made my day.
Yeah. Made our day, too. All right, we'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Great to have you. This game is tomorrow night. Matt will be there. Doug will be there. Well, I know Doug's ready. And I know you're ready.
Oh, yeah.
So, and Captain Shikalimi's ready. we love the Chief. All right, so... Yeah, it's March, guys. It's March. How about that? How crazy has the season been? I mean, Creighton is ranked 10th. They play St. John's. Okay, now, if St. John's wins the game, all right, it's not a total shock and surprise. But when they win by 20, it is a total shock and surprise. Like, they won the game by 20 points? Really? Providence, fighting for... You know, to Providence, every game is a game seven to them. They're trying to get in. They beat Villanova. Dick and I both said, well, geez, Gillespie, who'd been hurt, probably didn't play. Then we looked it up. Gillespie did play. Oh, okay. Duke. Now, I picked Virginia, as you recall, on Friday.
Yes, good call on your part.
A lot of that's home court. Duke is a very good team. Duke is just like everybody else, not a great team. Okay? That's just like everybody else. Duke is a really good team. I mean, Carey's really good. Trey Jones is really good. Okay? But there's nobody great out there. I think at the end, it's, you know, been... one of those years where, see, what I found interesting is I think everybody has said, okay, there's not a great team, there's not a great signature player. Okay. But what's happened is that you have a lot of really good spread out all over the place. A lot of really good spread out all over the place. That's why Minnesota can go into Wisconsin last night and battle them to the final shot. That's why I think tomorrow night, okay, here's one for you. I think Rutgers will beat Maryland tomorrow night. The game's at the Rack. It'll be sold out. And to be honest with you, Maryland looks tired. Okay? Now, everybody is this time of the year. So it's all relative. It's all relative. But the... you'd think after 30 games, everybody have, a little less in the tank. Rutgers finally got its break. They played 16 straight games. They got the weekend off. But you look at Maryland the other night playing Michigan State. Couldn't run with them. Could not run with them. Cassius Winston's been playing really well. Xavier Tillman's been playing well. And they get a contribution from somebody else. Sometimes it's Aaron Henry. Sometimes it's Rocket Watts. And they have a series of role players on that team. The kid Malik Hall's playing a lot better. But here's Maryland at home, crowd, wild, crazy, the whole thing. And guess what? Had no juice. They tried. Cowan tried. Stick Smith tried. But they're down to six guys. That's been Minnesota's problem. Minnesota has talent. Arturo's really good. Carr's really good. Right? Kauscher, Willis, those guys, good players. But they have too many guys playing 36 minutes plus. It's too many. It's one thing. Penn State, until Myron Jones went out, had spread its minutes out really well. Now, in this last stretch, they haven't been able to spread out the minutes. Now, getting Myron back really helps. Was he rusty on Saturday? Yeah. Did he come out of the game in good shape? Yes. Okay. All right. Myron came out of the game in good shape on Saturday. He played 23 minutes. And look, he'll get back into a game flow. That's why getting him back now was critical. And you can now play him in the regular season. That way he is set to go in the postseason. Critical. And he's going to be important moving. He'll be important tomorrow night. He'll be much more in the flow tomorrow night. He'll be much more in the flow tomorrow night. Believe me. Get back home. Heck of a game. Great matchup. But that's one thing. It's this 20-game Big Ten schedule is just an absolute grind. That's why I was talking about Dayton the other day. Dayton is a really good team. They will do whatever seed they get. I think that right now they're on the 2 line. Maybe there some people have them as a 1. I don't know. But they'll deserve it. They've had an awesome year. They're, 26-2? I watched them play on Friday night. Oh, man. Toppin's good. Crutcher's good. Oh, it's really the first time I've really seen Obi Toppin play. I think they play tonight, too. I might watch that a little bit tonight. Even though I know Duke's playing NC State, I'll probably watch a little bit of the Dayton game tonight. Just see Toppin play again. Because obviously I've got a Wooden Award vote. I want to know what I'm talking about with some of these guys when I'm sitting there to vote on the Wooden Award. That's why I wanted to watch Toppin play when we got to Iowa the other night. And the... But here's the deal. Dayton schedule's ranked 107. Now, they're a highly talented, quick, athletic team that's also really better than a lot of people they're facing. Well, they don't have to kill themselves in the last 10 minutes of a game to win it. And that does make a big difference. They have not had to. Again, this is when you're making that conference of major conference versus mid-major. Or in football, Power 5 versus Group of 5. You make the same argument over and over again with the Group of 5, Power 5. Did you have to play at Michigan? And then follow that by playing home with Ohio State. And then playing Michigan State. And then playing at Iowa. It's not that you can't, that a Group of 5 team can't win a one-off. They can, because they're very good, talented, and all well-coached. All right? They can win a one-off. The problem would be the grind of having to do it over and over and over again with Memphis. Over and over and over again. Penn State played Memphis. Memphis was the top group of five team. Right? And they gave a good account of themselves and still lost by two touchdowns. And most of their fans drove, and they had a good chunk of the stadium, so it was like a home game for them. But they were still two touchdowns shy of Penn State in the Cotton Bowl. It's the same thing in college basketball. Dayton is an outstanding team. Outstanding. Their only two losses were both in overtime. One's to Kansas. They're really good. But here's the issue. The issue is that when you have the 107th ranked schedule, you don't go to Michigan State, come home, play Illinois, then go back out and play Ohio State, then come back and play Penn State, then go out and play Iowa, then go out and play Wisconsin, then go out, you know, see where we're going here? Then you play Maryland. You don't get that every single night. In fact, anybody on Dayton's schedule in conference, even though there's some good teams, Richmond's very, very good, for example. I think St. Louis is good. So it's not like they have, the Atlantic 10 will get three in the tournament. The only way they get a fourth is if somebody outside the top three, outside of Rhode Island, Richmond, and Dayton wins the tournament. It's the only way they get four. But they'll get three. But if you were to schedule any one of those teams in the Atlantic 10 outside of Dayton, and they're on your schedule, that'd be a breather in the middle of the Big Ten schedule for you. Hey, great news. You're going to play Duquesne. And Duquesne's having a good year, by the way. Duquesne's a good team. Not a great team, but they're a good team. But they'd still be considered a breather. You're not out there having to grind it out against Iowa on their home floor with 15,000 people. Oh, and now you're done with that game. Now you got Michigan State. See, Dayton doesn't play that schedule. And they're really good. I mean, it's why I'm glad Dayton's going to get the seed they're going to get. They've earned it. And you watch them play, they're really, really good. But the argument you're always going to have, Power 5 versus mid-major or Power 5 versus Group of 5 in football, is not that they can't win the one-off or win a couple of games. It's when you got to do it every single week, week after week after week after week. That's the issue. Kim Jones, next half hour. Brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com.